Hi, budding structural engineers. Welcome to the structural engineering lectures on advanced steel designs. In the previous class, we have seen the designs of pressed steel tank conforming to IS 804. In today's class, we shall see the designs of transmission line towers conforming to IS 802, Part 1, Section 1, 1995, which deals with materials, loads, and permissible stresses. Section 1. It deals with materials and loads, and IS 802 Part 1 Section 2, which deals with permissible stresses. IS 802 Part 3 1978, which deals with fabrication, galvanizing, inspection and packing. And IS 802 Part 3 1978, which deals with testing. Right, now let us move to the discussions on this. We will see first the fundamentals and the classifications, etc. Before now, let us see this classifications, right? Basically, we do have the towers. The towers are of two types as per this IS 802. Either they are the suspension towers like this, right, or I do have this is how the suspension towers, right, suspension towers like this, right, or I do have the, right, these are suspension towers, or alternatively we do have, these are also suspension towers where we do have the high suspension insulator strings here, right? Whereas in the previous, these also high insulator suspension strings here, whereas these are V suspension insulator strings. These are V suspension insulator strings, right? Now also this is one type. The other type is the tension type towers like this, where the insulator strings will not be there. They will be directly connected to the cross arm. Therefore, these are what referred to as the tension towers, where the angle of deviations are more, like this, right? These are the tension towers, right? These are the two types. Now let us examine the general geometry, student. This is how the general geometry of a transmission line tower, right? We do have the main tower body consisting of the legs, which are connected by horizontals as well as diagonals, right? And this is what the straight vertical part, which is referred to as the cage, and these are what called the arms, cross arms, right? This is cage part. This is the main tower body, cage, cross arms. And this is what called the peak point, right? This is a general geometry of a transmission line tower, students. And that is how the same is now shown, right? And now let us see the different components or parts, right? Now we do have this, a tower base, which is fixed on the pedestals, which in turn is fixed on the footing, right? Footing over which pedestal, over which concrete bed block or pedestal, over which we do have these connections, right? Therefore, this is a tower base, and these are the columns, right? These are the main legs or columns, right? And which are connected by means of the horizontals like this. These main legs are connected by means of horizontals as well as diagonals like this, right? And this part is what called the waste part, from which Now it takes a fork or K frame. This is what called the K frame, because it resembles a letter K. Okay, and this lower part is what called the tower body, and here this K frame, between this we do have this tower window, and at the top we do have the tower top, we do have overhead ground wires, and this K frame is now connected by means of a beam which in turn is connected with the cross arms, from where the I type suspenders are suspended there, right? Therefore, our I type insulator strings are suspended, and even we can see that this is how the insulator strings to which what are connected are the conductor bundles are there, right? This is how the different parts of a transmission line tower, students, right? Now these are the photographs of the I suspension insulator strings, right? Like this. And the even now we can see that this is a tension tower. Actually, there are no insulator strings here. This is a tension tower. This is a suspension tower. These are the two types, right? And another schematic view representing a tension tower, right? That is all. Now let us move to the discussions, right? These are the classification based on the height to breadth ratio. We can refer them as a tower or mast. If H by B is larger, then such towers are what referred to as the towers or masts. The example for this one is Eiffel Tower, right? And are the other examples are that the towers of cable stayed bridges, pylons, or cable suspension bridges, right? They are also come under this tower category. They are what particularly referred to as pylons. And the example for the tower is the Eiffel Tower, where H is very large, height is almost to say around some 324 meters, right? That is of that much of height, very large, right? Like cantilever, right? Then next one is the self-supporting towers, right? The which are generally fixed at the base, at the bottom, right? The Eiffel Tower is fixed at the bottom, right? That is how, because it is a self-supporting large base and large height tower, right? Or the other others may be the cantilever action. However, their base would be small, but compared to that, their cross-section dimensions will be smaller. Therefore, in such a case, they are what called the cantilever type towers. Cantilever type supporting towers, right? And the other towers are sometimes referred to as masts, right? And they are what not self-supporting. They are not self-supporting because at the bottom they do have hinge at the bottom. Therefore, in order to achieve the stability, will be connecting them by means of these guy wires, maybe three or four guy wires from different four directions, right? And even if H by B, if height is less, even I require less breadth. Therefore, if H by B is less, then we do have the towers, as we have already discussed in the previous video, students, for water tank towers or staging, right? Their width of the tower is small, and even the other examples are radio transmission line towers. Radio transmission line towers, there the width is small, right? So the classification based on the H by B, or even would have the classification based on the fixity. Just now we have seen that they may be either self-supporting or fixed at the bottom, right? Fixed at the bottom. However, for small to medium heights only, these are applicable. The other types may be flexible towers, where we would have either the simple supports to the columns, or connected legs, right? Supporting legs. Or the third type may be semi-flexible, maybe one leg is fixed and other leg is simply supported or hinged as appropriate. And the fourth type is the self-supporting wide base. Here H is more, and therefore we require large base. The example for this one is Eiffel Tower, almost 324 meters height, right? And guide type towers, which comes under the mast. This one, just now we have explained that. And the third classification is based upon the angle of deviation as per IS 802, 1961, part 1, right? For tension towers, right? This is the code of practice for structural steel in overhead transmission line towers, part 1. As per that, for these tension towers, if theta is less than 2 degrees, then that is what referred to as the tangent towers. If angle of deviation, right? This is one tower, this is another tower, right? This is the in-between tower, second and third tower, right? Instead of going from first tower to second tower, I'll go in a particular direction. But there onward, second tower to third tower, if I'm deviating from that longitudinal direction, then that inclination is what called the angle of inclination or angle of deviation. If the deviation is less than 2 degrees, then that is what referred to as tangent tower. If theta is greater than 2 degrees and less than 10 degrees, then that is what referred to as small angle towers. And if the theta is greater than 10 degrees and less than 30 degrees, then medium angle towers. If theta is greater than 30 degrees and less than are equal to 60 degrees, then they are what called dead end or large angle towers. And generally, the heights of the towers varies from 20 to 40 meters. However, IS 802 refers to heights not more than 80 meters. That also we'll see at a later point, right? And even the breadth and depth or the base dimension should be in the range of 1/8 to 1/10 of the height for self-supporting transmission line towers, right? Then next classification is classification based on circuit system. They may be referred to as a single circuit towers, where one neutral wire and one power conductor system, one circuit, right? One circuit consists of one positive, one negative, and one neutral, one ground wire, right? That is a single circuit towers or double circuit towers, where two circuits will be there, right? 2 multiplied by 3. 6 wires, 6 power conductors plus one ground wire or 2 ground wires as appropriated, and multiple circuit towers where more than 2 will be there, more than 2 power conductor systems will be there, like this, right? This is how 2. Now what I am showing is, right, 1, 2, 3, right? 3 power conductors, single circuit, another on the other side, right? 1, 2, 3, 3, right? Therefore, this is a two circuit, right? Even we can say, right, 1, 2, 3, right, is right, one power conductor, second power conductor, third power conductor, right? On the left hand side as well as on the right hand side. This is what the two power conductor, right? Like this, right? Or even let us see this photograph, right? Even we do have, right,
here, right? Here, one power conductor, second and third power conductor, right? One circuit system, one ground wire, even 1, 2, 3 power conductors followed by one ground wire, right? That is how two circuit system, or there may be multiple circuit systems also, as just now we have discussed, right? Now let us see what are the different loads on the towers and how the loads shall be taken into account during designs. I hope so you are understanding the discussions, right? Now the application, these are applicable, this formula of self weight or dead load is applicable for self supporting towers, right? Where the self weight or dead load of the tower, dead load of the tower is given by capital W is equal to K H square root of M, where H is the height of the tower in meters and M is the overturning moment in kg meter about the base, and K is a constant which varies from 0.35 to 0.46, and W is the weight of self weight of the tower in terms of tons, right? And this is an empirical formula, right? And alternatively, even we would have another formula, right? W is equal to C K H Ft to the power 0.67, 0.875 square root of Fe plus P1 to the power 0.67 kgs, where Ft is the transverse load, right? If this is the longitudinal direction, student, if this is the longitudinal direction, right, of the tower, right, then transverse force, Ft, whereas this is the longitudinal force, P1 is longitudinal force, right? Ft is transverse force, right? And Fe is the vertical force. Ft is the vertical force, right? And that is all the notations. All these are in terms of kg, students, right? And C is a constant varying from 0.2 to 0.3. This is an alternative formula, empirical formula for finding out the self weight. And we do have for suspension towers, this K is given by square root of 1.44 L squared divided by 37 under root, where L is the maximum torque arm in terms of meters. And for dead end towers, this K is given by square root of under root 2.89 plus L squared divided by 13.5, right? Substituting with, now I'll get the self weight of the tower, right? And in addition to this, even we need to consider the dead load of a lineman along with the tool kit, say 150 kgs or 1500 newtons. And we do have the definition of weight span, which is defined as the horizontal distance between the two consecutive towers, right? That is the weight span, right? And second load is the temperature loads as per IS 800-1984. In the appendix A and B, we do have the contours available for minimum and maximum temperature. Even in IS 802 also, these are available. That we'll see separately, right? Therefore, the difference in temperature delta T is T2 minus T1 degree centigrade. Then also the radiation due to high voltage, because they are now carrying heavy voltage 132 kV or more as appropriate. Therefore, because of that high voltage, heavy temperatures will be there in the power conductors, like this heavy temperature will be there in the power conductors, due to which the design temperature should be increased by 17 degrees. And next, the third one is the wind loads as per IS 875 1984. Now even you would have a 2015 version also, that we'll see, right? There or we'll also refer as per IS 802 itself, because IS 802 has elaborately given all the loads, right? The wind load on the power conductors and the ground wires shall be reduced by 25% due to the swinging action, like this, right? Because of which the swinging action, then the wind load can be reduced by 25%. Means net effective is only 75% only. And also For the power conductors, they being the circular in shape, therefore there is a shape factor for them which is 2/3, because the shape of the power conductor is a circular, therefore the like this circular, therefore its shape factor is 0.67, right? And also the wind load on the towers, for which the exposed area of the tower is taken as the exposed area of the windward side plus 50% of the exposed area of the leeward side, that is the exposed areas. And what is the wind span? Wind span is defined as the summation of half of the spans on either side of the tower, right? Like this, L1 by 2 plus L2 by 2 is what called the wind span. So that these loads due to wind, due to swelling of these wires, swelling of the wires will be transmitted to this central tower, right? L1 by 2 plus L2 by 2 for the wind load, for calculation of the live loads. Here the live load is only the wind, right? However, for broken conditions, if at all this second span has broken, in such a case, the wind span is now given by, this is intact, right? In the working condition, L1 by 2 plus that of the broken, only 10% means L2 divided by 10. That is how for broken wire conditions, this is the wind span. However, this broken wire condition will lead to the unbalanced pull in the unbalanced pull like this in the tower, right? That we'll see at a later discussion, right? Because of which it gives rise to the overturning movement of the tower, as well as the torsion at that level, right? Torsion at the level. Therefore, what is the unbalanced pull? As per the code IS 802, 60% of the tension for the power conductors, whereas for the groundwire 100% shall be taken. Even we'll see these power broken conditions, right? For single circuit, one power conductor or one ground wire should be considered as broken. Whereas for double circuits, tangent and small angle towers, one power conductor or one ground wire should be assumed as a broken. Whereas for medium angle towers, two power conductors are the same circuit and on the same span, or one power conductor broken along with one ground wire. Either of these two options should be investigated for the design of the tower. Whereas for large angular towers, three power conductors on the same span are two power conductors plus one ground wire broken. Now, if let us see how the loads will be taken by the different members and different legs, right? This is how the if a tower is there, then this is how a tower having A B C D, horizontal members at that level, right? Then all the vertical loads PV are taken by this A B C D equally. All these vertical loads will be taken equally, right? However, coming to the tough, this is the longitudinal direction, student, right? Longitudinal direction. Therefore, this longitudinal force, right, will be taken by this AB, right, AB and CD, right, PH. This PH, longitudinal force is now given by PH, notated by PH, is taken care by AB, right, AB and CD, like this. This longitudinal force, right, is taken care by these two members, right. Whereas, if at all it is having a power conductor broken condition, then in addition to this longitudinal force, we do have the transverse force acting like this. Transverse force, if at all that is notated by PT, if at all the transverse force is there, then that transverse force will be taken by the other members, right? Here, right, PH is the longitudinal force which is taken by AD and BC, longitudinal force, whereas this transverse force is now taken care by AB and CD, like this. These members, right? This longitudinal force is taken by AD and BC respectively, whereas this vertical force is taken care by all the four legs A, B, C, D. And once the power conductor is broken on one side, then obviously it will lead to the twisting of this arm, right, which is connected to the cross section at that level. Therefore, now that will be under twisting like this. Therefore, now it leads to the torsion. That is how the torsion T or torque T or MT, notated by MT, is now resisted by the couple of the forces generated in the opposite direction as PT1, which are spaced at A, and PT2, right? These are the forces generated, or forces in the form of resistance generated in the members at that level, PT2, which are spaced at B. However, generally the shape will be a square shape like this, student, where A is equal to B. Therefore, in such a case, this MT is equal to summation, this clockwise couple of MT, because this is broken, therefore it will now try to rotate in the clockwise fashion. Therefore, resistance is offered by these two couples, PT1, which are spaced at A distance, plus PT2, which are spaced at a distance B. Therefore, T is equal to PT1 multiplied by A plus PT2 multiplied by B. Generally, A is equal to B. Therefore, in such a case, MT is equal to 2 times PT1 multiplied by A. Therefore, PT1 or PT2 is equal to MT divided by 2A. And PT2 is equal to MT divided by 2B. Right? Generally, if A is equal to B, then MT divided by 2A is equal to PT1 and PT2. That is how the forces generated in the members at that level. Now, let us, before we go to the caudal specification, students, let us see the derivation or the relationship between shape, sag or dip or tension in the uniformly loaded conductors like this, uniformly loaded conductors, right? Generally, if the conductors are connected between the two towers, obviously the dissolving its self-weight, which is acting in the form of UDL, uniformly distributed load. Therefore, now the shape, obviously, even you can say I'm just holding a power cable, right, which is having a shape in the form of a parabola, right? A parabola. Therefore, that is how now we'll try to derive the relation between these, right? And so this is the one left tower. At the top, I do have the support A, and also at the right side, I do have another tower, right? Therefore, B at the top, B, right? That is how the power conductor, one power conductor I'm taking out of three power conductors, right? And when the temperature in the winter season when temperatures are less, then the dip is less, D1 is less. Therefore, the tension in the power conductor will be more, power conductor, because the dip is less, tension is more. Whereas in the case of hot summer, the dip D2 will be more. Therefore, the tension in the cable is less, T2 is less, right? I think this is self-explanatory, student, you know. Therefore, in the winter, dip is less, tension is more. Once again, in the summer, temperature T2 is more. Therefore, in such a case, the dip D2 is more and tension is less. Tension in the cable or power conductor is less, right? That is less, right? That is how, once you understand that, then let us see the derivation part. Now, I'm assuming a section XX at a distance of X, right, at which the dip is given by Y. And these are my notations, that D1 and D2 are the dips, dips, the central dips corresponding to the temperatures T1 degree centigrade and T2 degree centigrade, where T1 is in the winter and T2 degree centigrade is in the summer, right? And T2 is greater than T1 degree centigrade or Fahrenheit as appropriate. And let T1 and T2 are the tensions, power conductor corresponding to T1 and T2 degree centigrade, right? Obviously, now the deformed shape is a parabola. Just now already shown that the equation of the parabola, we know that y is equal to 4dx divided by l square l minus x, right? Where d is the dip, right? Let us say this is equation one, student, and let w be the uniformly distributed load for unit length. Therefore, we know that the maximum bending moment is happening at mid-span, therefore that is equal to m, but that even at the mid-span, if I draw a tangent, that itself is a tension at that level, right? T1 or T2 as appropriate, but that itself is a horizontal force, therefore we can say that is equal to pH, right? Therefore, that bending moment m is equal to here, that pH multiplied by this dip is what the clockwise couple, right? That is equal to summation of anti-clockwise couple, that bending moment is happening in the downward direction like this, which is equal to WL square by 8, right? Therefore, that is equal to pH multiplied by d, right? Therefore, that is of the equation 2, but equating one with the two, one with the other, now I'll get the dip is equal to W square by 8 pH, and when the power conductor is spread and it is stretched over the supports like this, it is just spread and it is stretched, then between the supports A and B, then the length of this conductor along the arc is now given by x is equal to l plus 8 by 3 d square by l, right? Now where d is the dip and l is the horizontal length between the towers A and B, or first and second tower respectively, right? Then however, now because the power conductor is subjected to a tension T, therefore obviously the extension will be delta L, which is TL by AE, where A is the cross sectional area of this power conductor and E is the Young's modulus of elasticity of this power conductor material, and L is the length of that horizontal length of that between the two towers, and T is the tension. That is all. However, using this now, I can say at low temperature, let's temperature T1, the dip is now given by W1 L squared divided by 8 pH, right? Corresponding to that temperature, now I'll say the uniformly distributed load is W1. Corresponding to that, the dip is D1. Therefore, W1 L squared divided by 8 pH. But at the central location, if I take that pH itself is the tension T1. Let us say this as equation 5, student. Then where W1 is the vector sum of sulfate of power conductor and maximum intensity of wind means it is a vectorial sum, right? One is acting in the downward direction and another is acting in the transverse direction. Therefore, it is the vectorial sum, right? Like this, vectorial sum, that we'll see. This is what W1, and corresponding to that, the arc length corresponding to this T1 degree centigrade, the arc length is AC1B C1B, like this, A, C1B, right? Corresponding to temperature of T1 degree centigrade. That is now given by this, notated by S1. Therefore, as per this formula, now we can say S1 is equal to L1 plus 8 by 3 D1 square by L. Or, let's say this as equation 6. And similarly, when temperature is more in the summer, then corresponding to that dip is D2, and corresponding to that the sulfate of the, or the intensity of the load of this power conductor is equal to W2. Therefore, we can say D2 is equal to W2 L square divided by 8 pH, but corresponding to that tension is T2. Therefore, D2 is equal to W2 L square divided by 8 T2. Let us say this is equation 7, and corresponding to that, now we will say that the arc length given by AC2B, S2, right? That is how AC2, this one, right? AC2B, right? This is what that arc length is now given by L plus 8 by 3 D2 square divided by L. Let us say this is equation 8. But however, what is D1 and D2? I know from equation 5 and 6, and now substitute in the above equation of 7 and 8, these equations 5 and 6, then now we have S1 is equal to L1 upon substitution L1 plus 8 by 3 multiplied by W1 square divided by, multiplied by L to the power 4 divided by 64 T1 square L. That now works out S1 is equal to L1 plus W1 square L cubed divided by 24 T1 square. Let us say this is 9th equation. Similarly, S2 is equal to W2 squared multiplied by L cubed divided by 24 T2 square. Let these be given by 9th and 10th equations respectively, corresponding to which the stretch or the extension of these wires are delta L1 corresponding to T1 degree centigrade, T1 temperature, T1 L divided by AE, where T1 is the tension corresponding to that T1 degree centigrade, and corresponding to T2 degree centigrade, T2 temperature, delta L2 stretch is equal to T2 L divided by AE, where T2 is the tension in the cable corresponding to that more temperature. However, the change in arc length AC1B at temperature T1 is given by now delta S1. Which is S1 minus L1 plus delta L1. Therefore, now I do have that substituting with, now I will get this W1 square L cubed divided by 24 T1 square from this L1 plus W1 square L cubed divided by 24 T1 square. However, here actually this is minus LL gets cancelled, delta L1 is equal to T1 L divided by AE. Let us say this is equation 11. Similarly, that of the change in arc length AC2 given by delta S2 is equal to S2 minus L1 plus delta L2, which is now given by W2 square multiplied by L cubed divided by 24 T2 square minus T2 L divided by AE. Let's say this is the 12th equation. Therefore, at a change in arc length given by delta S2 minus delta S1, because delta S2 is more, that arc length S2 is more. Therefore, I am taking delta S2 minus delta S1 is positive. This is positive. Therefore, even T2 minus T1, more temperature minus less temperature is positive. Even this is positive, this is positive. That is, the change in arc length is equal to, we know from the strength of material or engineering mechanics, that change in length is given by alpha delta TL, where delta T is change in temperature T2 minus T1 multiplied by L. Therefore, substituting with, now I do have from this equation 11th and 12th, on the left hand side I do have W2 L cubed divided 24 T2 square minus T2 L divided by A minus W1 square L cubed divided 24 T1 square plus T1 L divided by AE is equal to alpha T2 minus T1 multiplied by L. Let's say this is the 13th equation. However,
Here, what is unknown? Unknown is the tension in the conductor when temperature is T2 degree centigrade or Fahrenheit. Therefore, corresponding to that, the tension T2 is equal to unknown at maximum temperature. Corresponding to that maximum temperature, tension in the cable is unknown. Therefore, that now I can find out T2 is equal to how much, that I can find out. Right? Even there are the specifications given in the form of maximum standard ratio limits also. Now let us examine these at a quicker pace, student. Right? Now I'll go to the coder specifications before I take up a numeric problem. Now let me. I hope, student, you are understanding the discussions, right? Then let us move to the coder specifications, right? I hope, student, you understood these discussions on the transmission line towers. In today's class, we have seen the discussions on the transmission line towers, right? In general, what are the different loads, classification of the towers as per IS 802, as well as general classifications, and what are the different loads and load combinations, and how the loads should be taken care as per IS 802 part 1 section 1. We'll now conclude the discussions. If you like the discussions what we had in today's class on transmission line towers, you just try to click like, share and subscribe to our YouTube channel, as well as you comment and turn on notifications, right? We'll meet in the next class with another discussion on the transmission line tower with a numeric problem. Till then, bye bye, students.